He's got his smile.
I do that just for fun.
I get to play. I'm easy to use, what can I say? Well, good morning and happy 4th of July.
Happy 4th of July.
I said I tried to find something of red, white, and blue, and it's a Costa Rica shirt. It's got the white, the blue, and the red parrot or whatever. So I'm missing my platform assistant, which I'm a little concerned about because anyway, let's hi Zoom. I gotta remember that Zoom is people are on Zoom. Welcome. All right, so as always, we're going to start with the lighting of the Christ candle. So we let that vibration we heard from the gong resonate through us. A little bit much, Dennis. Bring it down. It's going to be one of those days.
You're lucky.
Just let your light shine.
Yeah. I'm light enough. Okay, that's good.
No, stop. Okay.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Is that good?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
We can see you.
Yeah. All right. So we let go of all the gremlins. In the beginning was the One, one presence of the undivided and unmanifest, pure spirit of life, light, and love. In its generosity, it shared itself, its consciousness, and its love in the visible form of creation. We acknowledge this presence within us and as us. The creative energy of the divine feminine and masculine, expressing in all our giftedness and creativity. We acknowledge this presence in our companion, Mother Earth, and in all sentient beings. This universal presence in everything we call the Christ. And so we light this candle as a visible reminder of that Christ presence expressing in, as, and through us, in this present now moment. It is the truth, let us own it. And with great joy, we welcome back Kelly Dormeyer. And we're going to stand and sing our opening song, Joyously Evolving.
Joyously evolving,
my good or bad, I couldn't take it away. It was a joyously
So don't give up, no, I don't wanna give up. Don't give up, so don't even give up. Don't give up, we're in the power that is.
Don't give up,
we're in the power that is.
Don't give up.
We're in the power that will be.
Don't give up.
I only know it because we are.
Joy is the only.
In love.
Joy is the only.
From love. We are. Hey, 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 we are.
Joy is the only.
Joy is the only. Oh, joy is the only.
Joy is the only.
We have missed that.
Yes, we have.
All right. Yeah, boy, did that song resonate, huh? After the last year and a bit. So. I guess that's an Irish expression.
Yeah.
Year and a bit. So for my invocation this morning, once again, I'm going to turn to Stephen Barato. And he sends out these daily reflections. And this one is a combination of two of them, and it says, put love before beliefs or belief systems. Put love before expectations. Put love before personal preferences. Be the light. Have faith in the light. As the optical illusions dissolve, as the psychological illusions untangle, realize paradise has been here and now all along. We've just been so confined to the bubble of our perceptions that we couldn't see it. Here is where the circus of the surface gives way to deeper truth. The deeper you look, the more beauty you see. The higher you look, the more you see everything get reconciled into divinity. Darkness is exposing itself now. In this influx of higher light, there's nowhere to hide anymore. This is happening within us, in our interactions, and in our collective reality. The more reactive you are and the more you cling to your ego, the more difficult it will be. Stay in your heart space and choose love. The doorway to higher consciousness is wide open, here and now. Step into it with infinite love. I was just reading Richard Rohr's daily reflection this morning, and he did a whole piece about what was new about what Jesus taught. And it was that it was the imminence of the presence of God now, the kingdom of God is now. Up to then, it was always about the future. And the big change that he brought was to give people a hope that right now is when you can experience something bigger. You don't have to wait. So this morning as we gather, I hope that you're in that place, in that mind of realizing that there's something greater right now in this moment for us to experience. So we turn to our prayer list this morning. And as always, we have quite a list of people to pray for. So we start with continuing to pray for Sean Bartlett as he continues his cancer treatments, for Bob Castro, for Joan Oliver, Barbara McCarthy, for Christy Souza, Dale Frank, Indy and Karen Holman, Bree Seitz and her family, Geraldine Wood, Melody Jewell, Kathleen McIntyre, Jamal Meave, for Helen Simcox, Ed Beatty, Yvonne Bartlett, who had knee surgery this past week, for Ron and Vanessa Stewart, Jenny Rios, John Miller, Angela Burke, and Casey Price. So we hold all of these people in the light of our love. And so we take a moment then also to pray for any other intentions of people at this time. Together we pray. There is only one presence
and one power, active as the universe and as our lives, the all-loving goodness of God, and all is well.
So we have our daily word for today. And the word is this prize, freedom. In thought, word, and action, I celebrate my freedom. There are many ways to feel free. I may work hard to become financially free. I may plan trips so I can freely explore the world. I may commit to learning for intellectual freedom, or exercise my body for greater freedom of movement. Even as I do my work in the world to know freedom, I remember that I am always free at the level of spirit. No situation or circumstance has power over me. Every day and in every area of my life, I live from my divine nature, where I am wholly and completely free. Through my inner powers of understanding and faith, I recognize and embrace empowering beliefs. My spiritual gifts of strength and release keep me on course and help me free myself from habits that derail my spiritual growth. Through God within, I am grateful to be free. So we take a few moments to go into the silence and to connect with that spirit that keeps us, sustains us in freedom at all times. So I invite you to bring your attention to the breath. The breath is really another manifestation of the light. So we can either see, sense, or feel that presence of the light in our breath. Perhaps we can bring that attention all the way down through the feet into the center of the earth as we ground ourselves. And connect that huge energy that the planet is. We are one with the planet, we are part of it. We let the energy now come up through the gut, another great center of energy and of intuition. You can imagine that expanding, becoming felt presence. then back up to the heart space. And again, we just use the heart as the pump that it is to bring in more light, to expand itself into a bright circle of light. And allowing the attention to go up through the third eye to the crown. Opening up to the universal light and energy and presence. And we also are and have access to. If we are feeling any contraction in our life, we bring that to mind, something that's holding us back, keeping us constricted, weighing on us mentally or emotionally. We place it now in the heart center, that space, expanded space of light. We let the light embrace it. We let the light penetrate its constriction, the burden, the darkness. We allow ourselves release. We simply let go. We can imagine it going up through third eye, up to the area of the crown. And we let it go out into universal light to be transformed, to be returned to the source from which it came. Know itself as the light that it has always been. We can feel the burden lift. We can feel the freedom come into our being. We see the light brighten in ourselves, those around us in the room, indeed throughout all of humanity and the planet. As we see the field of light brighten all around the planet, shining now more brightly in the solar system. Indeed, in the universe. We are evolving and enlightening into our future to be the full manifestation of light beings that we are. And so it is. Now, Kelly has a very special treat for us for our performance.
Oh, beautiful, for spacious sky, for amber waves of green, for purple. From sea to shore. speak the stern impassioned strength of the fan for freedom beat across the wilderness. America, America, God mend thy every flaw, confirm thy soul in self-control, thy liberty in law.
Woo!
That was beautiful. I just want to check in with the technicians and folks that we are recording.
Yes.
I wasn't seeing it on there, so. Never doubted you. So, from time to time, I guess I feel like I have to go into the lion's den and talk about some things that are a little controversial. And today happens to be one of those days. Sometimes those are difficult conversations or they upset people. And at the same time, they're conversations that are not to be avoided. Because it's like in our families, we talk about things, right? Or not. But what I want to say is that when I speak to these things, I'm always speaking from the point of unity, of love, of care. So that's our starting point, just like our invocation. And I have a quote to start with. It says, "For to be free is not merely to cast off one's chains, but to live in a way that respects and enhances the freedom of others." And that's from Nelson Mandela, The Long Walk to Freedom. And I chose that quote specifically because I felt like it was really relevant to our experience of the last year and a half. And even still, I think it's still very, very relevant. We all want to be independent. We all want financial independence so that we can do things that we want to do. We want emotional independence also, so as not to be dependent on anyone, because that can feel very scary. What if they leave us? What if they die? We don't want to be vulnerable like that. And so a lot of our desire for independence comes from that fear of vulnerability. Yet how realistic or even desirable is that type of independence? Aren't we meant to be interdependent? Isn't that what spiritual community and community in general and the divine is all about? Being interdependent. Back in the day, the founders of this country wanted independence from Britain because of the unjustified financial burdens and taxes that were being imposed on the people. They wanted what was fair and just, and so they decided to revolt against their oppressors. They no longer wanted to be victims or victimized by the greed of distant overlords. And history would say that it was a very just cause. They had every right to do that. And in similar circumstances, we probably would have done the same. Because mankind, humans, are meant to be free. And when we feel that constriction upon us, we revolt. And yet, you probably know what I'm going to say. We look at our country now, how many people can say that they are really free? As we look at the recent events in this country, we could claim that people are independent and free thinking. Or are they? Not we, of course, but them. Unable to think for themselves with any degree of freedom and independence. Are they easily manipulated by media, social media, demagogues, the crowd? Do they latch on to every half-baked conspiracy theory without any real shred of personal knowledge or evidence and make just outrageous claims publicly on Facebook, on TV, whatever? Or on the other hand, are they so full of themselves that they believe their own opinions about any and everything without any proof? It seems that proof isn't even in the picture anymore. They become slaves to their own minds and opinions. And so I think we live in a time of the cult of opinions, with often no support or backing other than it is what I think and believe or have a feeling about to be true. In the bigger picture of things, we are in a battle for truth with a capital T. And that requires a willingness to be self-reflective, to be self-critical, and oh my God, that I might have to change my mind. Are you kidding me? That I may need some evidence for things? We can kind of joke about it, but unfortunately, there's a great truth to this. We live simultaneously, we know, in at least two dimensions, here and there, heaven and earth. And truth is the realm of there and of heaven. Truth is all about what was true yesterday, what was true a million years ago, what is true right now, what will be true in the future, and in another million years or beyond. And we can call that type of truth spiritual principle. Some examples might be that out of the Gospels, the Father and I are one, Mother and I are one, one of the sexes. Or I am safe and secure in God. Those are eternal truths. But applied to this realm in the here and now, they don't necessarily translate into experience in the way we might think. For instance, it doesn't mean I won't be in an accident, or that I might suffer from a debilitating injury or disease. We all know that bad things happen to good people, right? And yet, it is still true that the Father and I are one, that I am safe in God. Even if I have these experiences in my own life, I had one of those experiences being a car crash. Some people, unfortunately, don't understand that reality. And indeed, I would safely say that we, most of us, start out in life believing in a world or life whereby, because we know God is good, then my life is going to be just all positive. Have you had that experience? We can misinterpret how the absolute realm of heaven interjects with the relative earthly realm. And this past year, I think we've grappled with that, what it means to be a spiritual human being, what it means to have freedom, to be free in a public health crisis, what is my individual freedom and community responsibility. And it raised the age-old question, once again, of, am I my brother's keeper? To what extent do I make sacrifices? And to what end? And I imagine, like me, you may have been surprised at some people's answers to that question about, am I my brother or sister's keeper? There was a time, I think, when we would pretty much answer that in unison. but it no longer seems to be the case. And in his book, Universal Christ, which we read for our 7-week program the last time we had one, Richard Rohr says that the Christ is everything. And it's in everything and everyone. From A to Z in this realm. It's all part of this fallible kingdom here on earth that is interspersed with light. And yet it can be confusing for us to still discern what's real and what's true. And I give the examples. There are ample stories of ministers and good religious people whose churches believe that God would protect them from COVID. And yet we know what happened. We know the end results. Several of those ministers died, and many of the congregants. Many suffered unnecessarily. And science and medicine and vaccines are all part of the Christ light, and are from the mind of God. And yes, sometimes there can be issues with them, but it doesn't mean that they aren't part of the solutions that the divine gives us to our problems. God is in the ordinary and in the bits and pieces of every day. And I think of the story of the man who was in his house and the flood came and he went up on the roof and he was praying to God for rescue. And you know, the helicopter came along and down came the line and he shooted away. Someone else came in a boat and he told them, no, he was going to be fine, God was going to rescue him. And on and on and on. And he drowned. And when he goes to heaven, he has a word with God about why he wasn't rescued. And God said, well, I sent you the helicopter, I sent you the boat, you didn't get the message. And as we talk about these things, I think again, as I said, it's important to remember is that I'm talking about this as a spiritual leader who feels the need to do this. And it's coming from care. It's not coming from judgment or condemnation. Because, you know, I don't want to see people suffer. I don't want to see people suffer unnecessarily or die or their families go through great grief, etc. And I don't want to see people having long-haul symptoms from COVID. And so my desire for people to get vaccinated comes out of the kind of care and of concern that believes that I am my brother and sister's keeper. And I've had conversations in the last several weeks with one person in particular who got COVID some time ago, and she was part of a support group. And she told me that the symptoms that are talked about are like just the tip of the iceberg. She said, when she was in that support group, she said, you cannot believe the symptoms that people are dealing with. And it has to do with every single possible organ in your body. It's not, well, you know, it's not limited. She herself said that she had bone pain, and it was the most excruciating pain she's ever had in her life. Like, just really bizarre kind of stuff. And, you know, someone said to me, well, I'm not afraid to die. Well, I'm not afraid to die either, but I'm not going to speed it up necessarily. And the thing is, yeah, you'll be lucky if you die. But what if you don't die? And what if you have these horrible symptoms that are going to affect you and your quality of life is just going to be wrong? What about the financial bills? What about the care that may be required from other people? As I said, Jesus came to endure the crucifixion because it was his to do, a unique purpose and mission to fulfill. But it doesn't mean that it's ours to do also. We don't need to undergo crucifixion. And ultimately, we are free and independent to the extent that we can translate truth into this realm But we need to acknowledge the limitations that we face in that regard. We will age. We will die. Life won't always be a bed of roses, and everything won't always go our way. True freedom and independence comes from knowing our ultimate destiny, who and what we are. Yes, but there are also natural laws built into this earthly experience which must be respected. I'll give an example, like gravity. If you step off the roof of this building, you will fall to the ground, and you will hurt yourself or kill yourself. Or if you step out into traffic without looking, there isn't some presence there going to save you from the car that's coming. So we don't take unnecessary risks. We don't tempt fate, would be my way of seeing things. There's even a story in the New Testament from Jesus' life when he was tempted to jump off of the temple just to prove to himself that he was protected by God. He wisely declined the temptation. Spiritual truth won't be able to save us no more than it will save these poor young 12-year-old boys in Africa who were told by their military commanders, they were, forced into this army, who told them, no, you go out there, you'll be fine because the Holy Spirit is with you and the bullets won't kill you. You know, prudence is still a virtue, just as it has always been. And the reason why I decided to talk about this today is that I had a phone call from a friend of mine this past week, from someone who I would say would admit that she was very cavalier about the whole thing and didn't restrict herself, didn't get a vaccine, etc. Well, about 10 days ago, the inevitable happened. And she and her husband, daughter, her grandson now have COVID. And she said that it is, because she's still having the experience, the worst experience of her life. Just, she said, nothing comes near it. And of course, her husband is in ICU and is not doing well. And the thing that really came across to me on the phone was a sense of regret. Because, she and her husband went somewhere, they brought it home to the daughter and grandson. And the daughter is not someone who needs any more medical, challenges. She already has a lot. But there was this real sense of regret, of self-recrimination. And I would say even a sense of feeling stupid, to have not, taken this seriously. And as I stay in touch with Ireland, the variant is now hitting there. And it's doing untold damage. I mean, the hospitals are starting to fail. And it is worse than what we have experienced up to now. So from that place of caring, is where I'm coming from. It may not change anybody's minds, that's okay, but I will feel better for speaking my truth. And in the realm of independence and freedom, opinions are hypnotizing. What you have to do is ask someone for their opinion about something controversial, and then we can watch the sparks fly. And whenever we feel reactive in our thoughts, we can be sure of one thing. We're not coming from the deep peace of the Christ mind, but rather from the surface of the ego. And if we want to remain in a place of unity, we must allow for the peaceful disagreeing regarding politics and controversial issues of the day. Does spiritual community mean we agree about everything? I think that's called a cult. I know it's nice to be with like-minded people, but that doesn't mean we must agree about every single thing. And then we can still respect each other, and then we can still say things honestly to each other. Right now, if I asked you for your opinion on the Bible, Jesus, God Almighty, we would surely find that there's much diversity in our thinking. And that's a good thing. We must include in our beliefs the right of for people to be wrong in their thinking. Because remember the last time you were wrong? Like 50 years ago? The power to shape the thought or opinion is one given to us by the hand of God. But let us hold them lightly and gently with kindness, knowing that there is a great chance that they could be fallible. But let us use our freedom wisely so as not to become too independent. Remember that we came here to discover our unity above all else. Shouldn't we use our independence and freedom to foster unity? So I didn't get stoned. Okay. So we move on to our, I think it's our power statement for July. It says, with spiritual understanding, I know everything is unfolding for my highest good. Let's say that again.
With spiritual understanding, I know everything is unfolding for my highest good.
So today we're going to have our offering baskets passed. So if you want to prepare your offering, we're starting to kind of gear up again to do things the way we used to. But before it gets passed, we again are grateful for all of our blessings and prosperity, for all of the generosity of you and your fellow congregants for this past year and a half. I'm really grateful, personally. Thank you. And so we take a look there at our love offering. We just take those words into our minds and our hearts. And we feel the truth of that as together we say,
I give in love because I love to give.
And so it is. And so Kelly has another special song for us.
Funny how it turns out, everything can change. What I feel right now is not the same as yesterday. There's more than I imagined deep inside my heart. Emotions that I never knew, and this is just the start. So many things I've been missing, not watching, but now that's all in the past. Now I realize there's so much more to learn. I'm ready for the world, not scared of letting go. I realize there's so much more to feel, and my heart knows it's real. The part of me is so long forgotten. Calling, and this feels like home, 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 feels just like home. Learning how to smile again, reassure my heart, knowing I can face the things that used to be so hard. I look inside my heart and see a different part of me, what I didn't know I want in life, and it's everything I need. So many things I've been missing, not watching, but now that's all in the past. Now I realize there's so much more to learn. I'm ready for the world, not scared of letting go. I realize there's so much more to feel, and my heart knows it's real. The part of me is so long forgotten is calling, and this feels like home, home, home. Feels just like home. Feels just like home.
That's a Melissa Manchester song. It's actually from a Disney movie.
Yeah, no, I know it. I just couldn't remember who sang it. So we have blessed these gifts in our heart, and we dedicate them now to the work of unity here in the world wide. Thank you, God. So we have some announcements, a reminder that this is a year of renewal, transformation, awakening, healing, and wonder for us all. We continue, we're getting close to the end, with the energy teachings of the three, so you're invited to still join us on Tuesday mornings, if you'd like. And then we have a new group starting, Raising Our Racial Literacy, which will be led by Leslie and Sashila. And we will meet Tuesdays, starting on the 13th of July to the 24th of August at 4 p.m. to 5:30 on Zoom. So if you're interested, please see the e-bulletin, or you can talk to Leslie afterwards too. I'm really grateful that you're doing that, Leslie. Thank you. And we have a, I guess it's no longer new, meditation group on Mondays at 11. So you can see the e-bulletin for the Zoom link, although we won't be meeting tomorrow. The office is closed tomorrow. And let's see, Sydney. Oh, there you are. So this Wednesday at 9?
Yes, earlier.
Or earlier. The gardening group is going to do some more trimming and cleaning of our landscape out here. So if you would like to be here at 9 o'clock this Wednesday, please feel free to come and join in. Thank you for the great work that you do. This lady is amazing. You know, I came by here yesterday or Friday, and she was here trimming flowers out there, so they're a real blessing. Thank you. And we have our handiwork here as well today, beautiful altar that she's designed for us, and the flowers. So thank you.
That's from God.
Yeah, God is Californian. She's Southern Californian, actually. Not quite a Vanny girl, but but from Compton.
That is true. You're so great.
All right, so let us stand and pray and sing together. Thank you all for being here today and for celebrating the 4th of July. And we pray. Light of God
surrounds us. I am the light of God. The love of God enfolds us. I am the love of God. The power of God protects us. I am the power of God. The presence of God watches over us. I am the presence of God. Wherever we are, God is, because I am. And all is well.
And one more thing, I do want to acknowledge Rob Kearns. Rob is going to be moving to New Mexico.
Oh.
This is his second last Sunday. He will be platformed next week, but I won't be here, so I do want to acknowledge your presence for us. We will miss you.
Yeah.
Wow. Santa Fe is blessing. So.
Yeah.
All right, let us sing our closing song. Take us away, Kelly.
Peace in my life is growing because I choose love. Love's always present, it's what I'm made of. I choose love. We are we
represent.